one-man show. We can stop the rain. Welcome to Decent Life. I'm Lou Pugliafito. The call-in number is 212-245-7273. 212-245-7273. The guidelines for calling in are is to listen to your phone and not the show, because we're on an 8-second delay, which means that I'll be trying to talk to you and I'll be hanging it up and you'll be calling back. Also, if you like, lower the volume as well on the show, because we'll get feedback when you're talking to us. And if you like, you can give your first name and the location where you're calling from. And as you noticed, we do have a guest tonight, and a very, I think, well-respected guest. It's Mel Wymore. He's running as candidate for District 6, New York City Council District 6.
That's right.
Welcome, Mel.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
No problem. And basically, Mel has been involved in community work for over 20 years, especially with Community Board 7.
That's right.
I believe, and you were the chair of... and of the board, of community board, as well as of the chair of budget strategy as well.
I've chaired many committees on the community board, starting with the youth committee, the green committee, small business task force, urban planning task force, the 59th Street Rec Center task force. Now I am serving as the chair of the budget and strategy committee.
Mel, that's what I mean, you're well respected. You have gotten around. Yep. Not like me. I just sit in this little...
No, you don't. I know you get around, too. It's okay. Can't
But basically, before I get started, I just, because I don't have the graphics for it up, I just like to thank Kamana Kamkwalala for help producing the show with me.
That's awesome. Yes, of course. Thank you.
You're welcome. And so what I don't understand, and basically I think if a lot of our viewers don't, there's the community board and there's the city council.
Yes.
Can you just help us, you know, what's the difference between the two?
Oh, sure. So New York City has 8.5 million people, 5 boroughs, right? That's a lot of people to manage. And so the city is divided into 51 council districts. Each of those districts has a council member that elects one person to represent that district on the city council. Separate from that, the city manages itself through 59 community boards, and each community board represents about 200,000 people, and there are 50 members, volunteer members of that community board. It's like a mini city council, and so the member of the community boards are appointed by either the borough president or their local city council member, and then the community board serves as like establishing the budget priorities for that district.
Okay.
Making sure that land use applications and other municipal applications reflect the needs and desires of the community, that gets the input from the community before those approvals are made. And finally, and perhaps most importantly, serves as a place for community members to come and voice their opinions about the community, get services from agencies within the city. That community board acts as kind of a liaison between city agencies and the community members.
Okay, so I didn't realize this. So the community board's actually volunteer, and you have to get appointed.
You get appointed. You apply, and you get selected, and then you get appointed. And then you can serve, there's no term limits, you can serve a long time. I myself have served for 22 years on Community Board 7. That's a long time.
Yeah, so why now you want to make the jump from the Community Board to the City Council?
Well, you know, I love the work. First of all, I love the Upper West Side. It's a community that's made a home for me and my family. I love the progressive values of the Upper West Side. I love the diversity of the Upper West Side. More than that, I actually love the built environment, the quality of life, the light, the air, the parks, the subway transportation that's so accessible for us, the seniors and the youth. I mean, it's just a great neighborhood feel in an urban environment. And I have been serving as a volunteer for as long as I've lived there, 29 years. I started off, helping out in the neighborhood and joining block associations and stuff like that. But then when I moved into my apartment on 70th Street, there was a single room occupancy hotel across the street, and after an unfortunate event when someone jumped out of the building, I got involved by organizing, first investigating what happened, knocking on the doors, getting to know the residents of that single room occupancy hotel. And it turns out they didn't have food or good health care, so we organized the block, organized the tenants association, raised some funds, started a food program in the basement. The rest is history. That's a whole block transformed.
But what you touched upon is it felt good, right?
To go it felt there awesome, and yeah. Awesome. And that's where I really learned the power of organizing community at the grassroots level, because not only does it help and serve the people that feel marginalized and disempowered, but it totally helped us as the other members of the block get connected to each other, connected to local businesses. The guys that used to feel scary to us that were now our friends, we, you know, gave them high fives on the block when we were going by, and it just, you know, really made a big difference for the neighbors to know each other.
Because what happened?
Like you say, love thy neighbor.
Yeah,
right?
That's right. Love your neighbor. Because what's interesting, way back when I was a little kid in the city, people really were connected. Then with the turnovers and rental property, so people got, I think, disconnected. And now what we're trying to do is get everybody connected, everybody involved. And what they do say is actually volunteering makes you feel better than just donating money.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, you go out there and do the right.
If you have a chance, get out on the street. You know, whatever it takes, meet people, do something that's going to help everybody. Pick up the garbage. Make sure that you have a block association meeting, you know. Sell, have a flea market on your block. Whatever it takes.
And I just realized that the park that's right next door to M&M Studios, have you been involved in, right, to raise the money for Gertrude?
Yes, I spent a lot of time on that park. What happened was there's an empty pool, a broken pool. It was cracked in the 80s or probably early 90s when some of the developments went up next door. And that crack was never repaired. So it was just this giant gaping hole in the ground, and the kids in the community had no place to go in the summers. It used to be a thriving community swimming pool, and all of a sudden, from years, it lay just empty, like a ghost, like a carcass.
Yeah, because I walked by it all the time, covering the studio.
Okay,
So then we
managed to get a couple $1 million from a local developer, and then we had to decide what to do with the $2 million because it wasn't enough.
I gotcha.
And so I, again, brought together all the stakeholders, and we came up with a vision for this center. And it took 15 years to raise the money to fulfill the vision, but we did, and it was opened up last year.
Do you work too, as well as volunteer?
Of course.
I tell you, when do you sleep?
The volunteer is way more fulfilling.
I think it keeps you going.
It keeps it going. It's way better.
So anyway, let's go into some topics.
You know,
and I think that I touched upon it is that when I grew up on the Upper East Side, I'm not sure if it was the first section of the city to get started with gentrification, but you know, it sure wasn't the last one, as we see in the city. And there's a problem, I think, about housing, right? Everybody talks about housing. People can't afford the rents. The middle class is getting squeezed out. We got to live in New Jersey, Pennsylvania, upstate New York, and travel 3 hours to go in. So basically, for housing, what is your definition of like affordable housing? What are we looking for?
You know, the way I think about affordable housing is that when you look at a community, you want to make sure everyone who works in the community can afford to live in the community. Now, that doesn't happen on the Upper West Side. Most of the people that work on the Upper West Side, they come from outside of the West Side in order to work in the Upper West Side. But the principle that I stand by, which if we had real affordable housing, every job that there is in the West Side would pay enough to pay the rents for people who live on the Upper West Side, and every rent on the Upper West Side would be low enough so that if you're working any job, you could afford something in the Upper West Side.
Okay.
So that's how I think about it. It's not like there's these average median income numbers, they're called AMI.
Okay.
In the city policy, we talk about the area median income, which is, you know, take a region, what's the medium, and then you look at affordable being like 60% of the area median.
Okay.
But on the Upper West Side, the incomes are so high that median is pretty high.
That's
right?
For sure.
So it's very, not affordable for a lot of people.
It's
affordable
affluent.
Is not that
it's affluent. Just like the Upper East Side is pretty affluent on now.
Yes, it's similar.
I understand.
Not
that.
Quite as high, but almost. The East Side's a little bit higher than us.
Yeah, except what my salary was. But anyway, yeah. Going on, so what, during your community board actions, what have you accomplished so far under housing?
In 22 years, you want to know all this?
No, just lately, you know, because I saw something about 600 units.
Okay, so let's go through that. When I was chair of the community board, I did a few things. So one of the most important things that I did was kind of reform the way we negotiate land use review processes. So in certain instances, when a developer comes into a community, they're required to apply for a permit. And that's usually because they're piercing the envelope of the zoning resolution or changing something that wasn't planned by the zoning resolution. So a big developer came and asked to build 3 million square feet of towers, mixed-use towers, on Riverside South. And that's five high-rises. I say five. Five high-rises. And so rather than just like pick at the developer and say, we don't like what you're doing, what I did is I got all the architects, urban planners, teachers, parents, affordable housing advocates, residents together and said, okay, well, let's create our own vision for what this place looks like.
All right.
And what do we need? And out of that negotiation, we ended up with a brand new school, the first one in 30 years on the Upper West Side, 600 units of permanently affordable housing, and $20 million for the Riverside Park.
So affordable housing is, give me a ballpark number what affordable would be.
Well, in this particular case, the affordable housing would be 50% of area median income. So it's, I don't know what the price.
Okay, so for example, if it was 100,000, it would be 50.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah.
Oh, so your income. Is that what you're saying?
No, the rent would be.
Oh, okay. So whatever the global rent is.
Yeah, the rents.
Okay. So,
I mean, the rents would be commensurate for that person to be able to pay that.
Okay, so affordable housing means if you're rich, you can live in that area.
No, it means if you're not as rich as everyone else, but you can.
No, because you know what I'm getting at is that you're saying that if you're so much money, this is what affordable in that area is.
Right.
Did I catch that wrong?
It's what would, okay, generally speaking.
Well, what I'm trying to say is how does the.
People are expected to spend 30% of their income on housing.
Okay.
Right? 30% of their income. So affordable means that if you make $50,000, you want to spend a third of that $50,000 on housing.
Okay.
Okay, and you divide that by 12.
Okay.
So you end up with
I gotcha. All right. So I see how that works. But basically, we can't expand that to the whole city, can we? That, you know, the medium income is, or is it just a district by district?
It's the region, and sometimes the region is defined by the community district. Sometimes I don't know what the particular.
So does affordable housing also include like the public housing and the, you know, New York City housing
authorities? There's so many different kinds of affordable housing.
Yeah, because you have Section 8 and so on.
There's Section 8. There's public housing. There's HDFCs. There are TIL programs. There are rent stabilization, there's rent control, there's a plethora of programs that subsidize housing in one form or another. And so, you know, coming up with a cogent affordable housing, quote unquote, affordable housing program for the city is a complex endeavor. It's not an easy thing.
Right.
But we can, first of all, work very hard to preserve the affordable housing that we have. Secondly, we can make sure that we collect the appropriate taxes to build affordable housing as a matter of principle for the city to build actual affordable housing rather than, you know, just take a percentage of what developers are building. Because when we do that, we also give them tax breaks.
Right.
So
Does that make sense?
We lose revenue.
Right.
So I'd prefer to just collect taxes and build human scale affordable housing.
Yeah. And I see that you had some steps in there like taxing empty apartments and stuff like that on your website.
Putting a vacancy tax
or vacancy fines.
So basically, that's for empty storefronts.
Oh, I got you.
For landlords that keep their storefronts empty. We have on the Upper West Side just block after block of empty storefronts. Okay. And it really reduces the quality of life on the Upper West Side. The neighborhood character changes when you have empty stores that are dark at night. They collect garbage in front of them. It really loses vitality of the neighborhood. And so what I have come up with is a three-point plan for small businesses to keep those storefronts vibrant in our district. And first one is to cut the red tape for small businesses.
Okay.
The second idea is to put a fine for long-term vacancies. So if you keep your storefront vacant for more than a year, you get a fine for that. So it shifts the economics. And the third one is to support small businesses in expanding their leases, like extending their leases, renewing their leases, because that's when they lose their businesses. The landlord comes in at the end of a lease agreement and says, okay, great, it was great to spend 12 years with you, but now we're going to double your rent.
Okay, so the driving factor was the rents.
The rents are often a big part of the conversation.
So if you put the vacancy tax on that, you think that you'll lower the rent so more stores?
I don't know. The vacancy tax is to encourage the rental of empty spaces.
Right.
So that solves part of that problem. The lease renewal is to help the small business stay in business. Right?
Okay.
And cutting the red tape helps get into business and also to stay in business, because the red tape hampers small businesses drastically.
Well, I guess
on the Upper West Side.
Well, I think anywhere, I've seen signs in the city that the city's done this to me because all this regulation and red tape, and I believe
it's onerous. Yeah. I was the owner of a small business on the West Side, and I opened it and closed it for a lot of reasons, but the biggest reason was the rent increase.
But doesn't the city have like a liaison to help you understand this? Which is, I think, kind of like...
There's a small business administration, but it's not effective. Obviously not effective, because we have all these empty storefronts. We have these businesses going out of business and people trolling for banks and drugstores to come in, you know?
So through your time through the community board, what are the greatest obstacles that you've seen for the city to get a cohesive strategy for affordable housing? Is it just that nobody's willing to stand up to the big real estate developers?
That's part of it. You know, I have a history of standing up to big real estate, like not only at Riverside Center, at the single room occupancy hotel where I started the food program, we had to like really stand down the landlord. And I believe that we need strong policy that levels the playing field between real estate and the local community. And because real estate is so entrenched in politics with their donations, both at the city level and the state level, it's very difficult for politicians to stand up. However, I return checks from developers.
That's what I saw on your side.
I don't just not accept development money. I actually, if someone goes through my online system and gives something before I even know it, as soon as I see it, we've returned the check.
That's good to do.
No, I don't want to be encumbered by any real estate interests or any other interests.
So even with the city council is influenced by the real estate developers.
Oh, yes, that's absolutely. I mean, this is a very permissive.
Okay.
City
council. So is that what you mean by, you know, why we have to change things? Because you mentioned that you want to retake the New York State Senate. How are we doing? Is that because we got to get rid of the real estate developers? Or
yeah, what? I mean, look, we have eight Democrats that were duly elected Democrats who are caucusing separately from the Democratic Party, giving the Republicans the majority of the New York State Senate. And when the Republicans have the majority of the New York State Senate, they set the agenda. So nothing Democrats want, actually, if they can tell you, they never vote against their progressive policies,
right,
like, you know, environmental protection, universal single-payer health care, women's reproductive health, gender rights, ethics, campaign finance. None of that stuff makes it to the floor of the Senate, so they can't vote against it or for it, because the Republicans control the agenda.
Okay.
And why do the Republicans control the agenda? Why do those eight Democrats caucus separately? Do you know why? They do, because they were paid to do so, mostly by the real estate lobbies, but also by the charter school lobbies.
So do we need to focus on these
state
eight
senates?
And these eight
We have
Democrats
to win back the Senate. Yeah, absolutely.
Even because you have the eight Democrats, if so, would we put
they have to either in? They have to either come back to the Democratic Party, or they have to be replaced by real Democrats. One or the other. And we're working very hard on that.
I know. It's hard because basically based over the last 30 or so years, it's all been about money. And so it's tough. You know, I think I'm a little older than you. And I saw a time pre-Reagan when things were a little bit different,
Yeah, no, I mean, money, special interests have gotten into politics, and we have to do everything we can to go against.
So I have a little topic near and dear to me.
Okay, let's hear
it. Which is marijuana legalization.
That's near and dear to you?
But for one reason.
What? I'm dying to hear.
Is because of the secondhand smoke.
Okay.
So if we're going to legalize it in the city, how do we prevent it from, because, you know, we're highly dense, how do we keep it going from apartment to apartment, and how are we going to do that? Because I'm all for people want to smoke.
It's the same as the smoking ban, smoking ban would apply to marijuana ban.
Okay, because you know what's going to...
Right, if you're smoking, you're smoking. It doesn't matter what you're smoking.
Okay. We'll see what it gets, because that's what bothers me, because I had to go on a few doors in my building, because, you know, I do have young children, to knock on the door and says, hey, will you knock it off or blow it out the window? Because I don't want to smell it in the hallway.
I see that.
And everything else. So, you know, it was great for Colorado. You know, you spread out so far and wide. But, you know, in New York City.
You smell it now, right? You think it's going to change this because it's legalized? We have more chance of actually regulating.
They're not smoking in my building anymore.
The smoke and regulating the abuse than we do if it's illegal.
Yeah. Well, no, I understand that. It's a revenue maker.
Yeah, so it's an opportunity.
But I just think that people understand when they're smoking marijuana, that they do not trample on other persons' rights as well.
The same as smoking tobacco. Same thing.
Same thing, yeah.
Yeah, they're both dangerous.
Well, they're still moving to my building. They're taking care of it. I'm just joking. Let's just move on to other things. Because what I noticed, too, is that you're looking at to reduce the carbon footprint?
Yes.
And on the Upper West Side?
Yes.
So how are you doing that?
Okay, so... 70% of the carbon generated by New York City is generated by our building heating and cooling.
Okay.
70%. That's a lot. Whereas, by contrast, outside in the rural of New York, it's more like 35% from transportation, I think.
All right.
And 25% from buildings. And then there's other stuff that uses up the rest of it.
So you're going to focus on green buildings?
Green buildings. So replacing heating and cooling with ground source heat pumps with geothermal energy and electrifying the pumps will significantly, we could meet an 80% reduction of carbon footprint by 2050 if we did that. Okay. And we electrify cars. So we need to basically electrify the city with two ways. One, focus on buildings. Old buildings, you switch them to number two oil, and then when their boilers get old enough, you replace that with ground source heat pumps. New buildings should start off with ground source heat pumps, and everything should be driven by electricity. Because it's the carbon.
Okay, so you're talking about this thermal type of technology.
Yeah, efficient heating and cooling.
Okay, so
and it uses electricity, but a very small amount of electricity.
All right, so we're going deep beneath the city, or I don't know how deep.
You drill down. In the winter, you pump the heat out of the earth and into the homes.
Right.
And in the summer, you pump the heat out of the homes and into the ground.
I think some places are investing in that.
It's like a very promising technology.
Okay, so... You know, I know you're running against, we're coming short up on time, you know. Because I really want to go back to affordable housing, but there's so many other things on the list.
Yes.
You know, because...
There's a lot of things to deal with.
Yeah, there is. And so your opponent is Helen Rosenthal, right?
Yep.
So...
Not Linda Rosenthal. Very important distinction.
Okay. Well, I always thought it was Helen. So we're okay.
Well, Linda's our state assembly woman.
Okay,
she's beloved.
Okay. So basically, how do you... What's the difference between you and Helen?
Well, I already mentioned the difference is that Helen voted for the citywide upzoning, and she also, when we asked for a moratorium on super tall buildings, she did not act. And real estate really has a huge impact on so many of the issues. Like I said, the rents that are soaring, keeping us, you know, people being afraid of losing their homes, seniors not allowed to, you know, getting squeezed out of their homes, schools being overcrowded, storefronts emptying out. Those are all related to real estate control, and if we don't step up against real estate in a real way, not band-aid solutions, but in a real systematic reform of our zoning code, we will not lose, we will not win this battle. And Helen has not been doing that. And I have been doing that since the day I joined the community board. Actually, before I joined the community board.
Has the New York, was it the previous election, or now does the New York Times support you?
I won the endorsement of the New York Times in 2013. We haven't had an interview yet.
Okay.
Okay.
Soon
to come.
Soon
to come. Right.
Okay. So I just want to get back to, because I think there was something mentioned about the city council is unresponsive to something. So is it the city council in general or just Helen?
Well, there's unresponsiveness has to do with the kinds of constituent services. So basically, we, you know, one of the things that had me run was the fact that people were coming to me and saying, I've been calling the office, I haven't gotten a response. And we hear that story a lot. And I was
Is it for really, particular problems?
I was very worried when especially low-income families and marginalized communities were complaining that they couldn't get the help they needed and they had to go elsewhere. And I feel the city council needs to be particularly focused on your local constituents.
Okay.
Really, at home, you know, that's what you're doing. That you roll up your sleeves and you connect
and
with your
better.
Local community. Absolutely, we can do better.
All right, so we're running up on the close here. And I know we can do better.
And we need to be inclusive.
All right.
We need to make sure people have the full voice
right.
before we make big decisions. And we need to make sure that we end with tangible results that include and better the lives of all
That's
people.
Right.
Not
everyone.
Just some people, all people
That's
on the
right.
Upper West Side.
Because including diversity, I think people
Inclusivity
don't...
Inclusivity is
all inclusive.
It's not exclusive of anyone. That's what I mean.
So I don't know if I took away your campaign line, but we got about one minute. Is there anything else that I didn't cover that you wanted to say?
Look, I think New York City needs to be the leader for inclusive, sustainable, just society. We have an opportunity to do that, and this is the time. Now, in the time of a very precarious administration at the federal level, the city is where we can make a difference. And if we don't do the kinds of grassroots organizing and neighbor-to-neighbor conversations that we
Right.
need to have, then we are missing an opportunity, and I'm here to lead that, to support people who are interested in those local discussions, and to really create the kind of Upper West Side that shows that we can do this, we can care for each other, we can be strong, we can protect our most vulnerable neighbors.
That's right.
And that's what that's why I'm running.
And so, Mel, the primary is on September
12th. Tuesday, September
That's
12th.
That's right.
He's a Democratic primary for city council. And my name is Mel Wymore. And we have an office on Broadway and 80th Street if you want to come out and volunteer for the campaign.
And we can stop the rain. And all you need is love. Thank you,
right,
Mel.
Thank you so much.
So long, everybody.
It.
Thanks
all
for
right.
watching.
Thanks, Lou.